Well, it's such a joy to see you all here today as we gather for the Lord's Day for worship. Thank you for joining us. For those of you who don't know, my name is Pastor Patrick. I'm the associate pastor here at Grace Church. Pastor Peter, the senior pastor, is currently away. He's in Colombia. He'll be returning this week. He'll be back in the office on Thursday, but please be praying for him for safe travels and also for his mission in Colombia with the church plants that we are currently serving. A couple things going on here at Grace Church that we want to let you know about. One of which is Meals on Wheels is currently ongoing for Grace Church throughout our community. And so if you're interested in that, please stop by the Welcome Center after the service. We'd love to get you signed up. Next, we have Breaking Bread and Bronco. It's a potluck. We're having on April 2nd, immediately following the second service from 12 to 3. We'd love for you to join us. Bring a dish, but let's all have a good time together. Next, we have a corporate prayer meeting coming up April 2nd, that same day, later in the evening, but this is where it gets a little different. Typically, we do them during Sunday school. We do them in person. We do them together. We're going to do it together, but we're not going to be in person. It's going to be on Zoom. And so you're going to get a login thing. You can sign in. Or if you're like me and you're not very good with technology, we'll get you a phone number. You can call in. Either way, we'd love for you to join us. It's 15 minutes as we gather together as a congregation to pray. Next, if you are interested in serving on the lawn mowing team here at Grace Church, as spring is supposedly here, I haven't seen it yet, but it's I heard it's on its way. We would love to get you involved. Please mark your connection card, and we'll get back to you. And then, Lynn?
Good morning. Saturday, April 29th, Lifeway Women Live will be in Des Moines, and they will have five speakers for the day. And we're hoping to get a group of ladies from Grace who would like to attend. If any of you have done a Bible study with Jana in the last few years, one of the speakers is Jen Wilkin. She will be there along with four other ladies, three of which I've done studies under just online. We hope to leave Friday and then head down, share a meal together, and then Saturday sit under some wonderful teaching that will grow our faith, and then we'll come home when the event is over, and we'll be home shortly after supper. So if you're interested, mark your connection card, call the office, or talk to me. Hopefully you can come.
Thanks, Lynn. And as spring is on its way, summer is on its heels, and so if you're interested in summer camp or your student is interested in summer camp, we love to get them involved. We support two camps here at Grace Church, Hidden Acres and IRBC. One's in Dayton, Iowa. The other one's in Ventura, Iowa. Either way, you'll be in good hands. Your students will be in good hands, and it's a great place for them to have fun, make friends, and grow in their faith. And so we want to support that, which means Grace Church pays $150 of the tuition for your student to go. And we want to come alongside you in helping you and discipling your kids. And so if you're interested in that or you have questions, there's a brochure right now from IRBC. We're still waiting on Hidden Acres to get us theirs. But either way, we'd love to get you more information and help you find the right place for your child. And then if you're new to Grace Church, would you do me a favor? Would you stop by the Welcome Center after the service and say hi? I'll be standing there. We have a gift for you. Also, if you would do us one slight favor, in your welcome bulletin, you'll see that in the middle there's a connection card. If you fill that out and bring that, I would greatly appreciate it. That way we know who you are and who came to join us. But we would love to get to talk to you. If you have any questions, please let us know. If you want to know more about the church, we'd love to give you that information. We have a Good Friday service coming up April 7th at 12 p.m. over the lunch period here at Grace Church. So one service for the entire congregation. During the lunch period, we recognize a lot of people are at work, so the service will be relegated to 45 minutes. That way you guys can get back to work on time. And then Easter Sunday is coming up April 9th. That will not be here at the church, and it will not be two services. It'll be one service at the Performing Arts Center, which is adjacent to Algona High School. And so it's a large auditorium. We have room for the entire church. We also have room for the community. And so our challenge is for you to invite your friends, your family, your neighbors, your coworkers. And at the conclusion of the service, as you walk out, the ushers will be giving you another one of those cards to invite another person to join us Easter Sunday. At this time, we're going to go ahead and start our worship prayer. And as we do so, let me read to you from Isaiah 40, verse 9. It says, "Go up on a high mountain, O Zion, herald of good news. Lift up your voice with strength, O Jerusalem, herald of good news. Lift it up, fear not. Say to the cities of Judah, behold your God. Father, that's why we gather, is to behold you, the one true living God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. And we pray, would you give us eyes of faith to behold you in your beauty? Jeremiah, Isaiah, you also tells us, your eyes will behold the King in his beauty. They will see a land that stretches afar. Father, you are our King. You are the reason we exist. You are the reason we have breath and life, ultimately for your glory. And so, Lord, we gather to worship you because you are worthy this morning. We pray that you would grant us strength and good hearts to be heralds of good news, to be proclaimers of your excellencies, to declare to the world that our God reigns. And that you have provided a way through your Son for sinful mankind to be reconciled to you, to have life eternal. And so, Lord, be with us now. Fill us with your Spirit. In Jesus' mighty name, amen.
Please join us.
I'm walking in freedom for God's sake.
Jesus is waiting, God so loved the world.
Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. For yours is the kingdom, the power and glory. Forever you reign, forever you reign.
Salvation reigns. seated.
We want to take a little bit of time here to pray. A lot of you know that Marlis Moe passed away this last week, and her funeral was yesterday. So we'll be praying for her family. And also for Pastor Peter, who is in Columbia with Jesse. Peter will be preaching this morning. He already might have preached this morning at Pastor Franklin's church, and this evening he'll be preaching at Pastor Samuel Reyes' church. So would you pray with me? Father, we do just come before you. Lord, you are good. You are gracious and merciful. Lord, you are sovereignly ruling over all things in this universe. And so we give you praise. We worship you. We thank you and we praise you for your goodness to us. Lord, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth that it is, that it speaks into our lives. Lord, it is the foundation for our lives. Lord, I pray that this church would continue to be gospel and Bible-centered in its preaching and teaching. And Lord, I pray for the other churches in this community that the gospel and biblical teaching would be first and foremost in all that they do. And Lord, I pray for the churches in this state that they too would be gospel and Bible-centered. And for this country, Lord, and around the world, that your word would go forth. And Lord, you would accomplish with it whatever you deem necessary, because your word is truth. And so we lift this up to you, Lord. And we do pray for those in Columbia. We pray for Pastor Peter as he preaches, and for the pastors there, Lord, that they would be gospel, Bible-centered preaching and teaching. And Lord, that people would come to know you. People would be saved by you, that you would do a mighty work in the lives of those in Columbia, but Lord, not only there, but around the world. Would you reign through your word in people's lives? And Lord, we lift up to you the family of Marlis Moe. In the middle of mourning, Lord, it gets very difficult, so we pray that you would grant comfort, that you would grant strength and endurance, sense of your presence in the lives of Marlis's family. And Lord, that they would not mourn as those who have no hope, but that they would find their hope in you. Lord, through this, would you draw people to yourself so that they could see you for who you are. Lord, again, we pray for Pastor Peter and Jesse, that you'd be with them. And Lord, we lift up these ties to you. Lord, we pray that you would use them for your kingdom, for your glory, that Grace Church would be wise and discerning in how we use them. Lord, you are good. You have blessed us in so many ways. And Lord, this is just, may it be an act of worship where we are just giving back to you what you have blessed us with so much. So we commit it to you, Lord, and pray that you would use it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. please stand and join us again?
There is love that came for us, humbled to a sinner's cross. You broke my shame and sinfulness. You rose again, victorious. Faithfulness none can deny. Through the storm and through the fire, there is truth that sets me free. Jesus Christ, who lives in me. You are stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken. You have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen. Jesus, you are Lord of all. No beginning and no end. You're my hope and my defense. Came to seek and save the lost. You paid it all upon the cross. You are stronger, you are stronger. Sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen. Jesus, you our Lord of all. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. So let your name be lifted higher, be lifted higher, be lifted higher. You are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all. You are stronger, sin is broken, you have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen, Jesus, you are Lord of all.
The grace of God has reached for me from the raging sea.
Father, we praise you as a God who is strong to save, faithful in love. Lord, we thank you for paying our debt of sin, Lord, the sin that's punishable by death. And Lord, out of your great love, your great mercy and grace towards us, you sent your Son to be that perfect sacrifice, to pay the penalty for our own sin when we were unable to pay it ourselves. Lord, we thank you for that. Father, we praise you. We recognize you as this awesome God for your glory, Lord. Glory to the Father, to the Son, to the Spirit. And Father, the more we know you, the more we're able to see you, that the more you reveal yourself to us, Lord. We know that the result is joy in our lives, a joy that is irreplaceable by worldly things. And so, Father, we pray that you would continue to reveal yourself to us. Lord, we pray that you'd continue to work in our lives, conform us to the image of your Son Jesus, that we would grow in joy, in faith, in obedience, and that you'd be honored through it. Father, as we continue to worship this morning, we pray that you would bless us as we open your word to us. Father, bless Pastor Patrick, the words that come from his mouth. Lord, we pray that they be rooted in truth. And Lord, give us open eyes and ears to receive that. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, if you would, turn with me in your Bibles to Genesis chapter 4. Genesis chapter 4. We've been preaching verse by verse through the first book of the Bible written by the prophet Moses, and today we come to the conclusion of Genesis chapter 4. And we'll begin in verse 16. The text is on the screen behind me. Moses writes these words under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit of God. Then Cain went away from the presence of the Lord and settled in the land of Nod, east of Eden. Cain knew his wife, and she conceived and bore Enoch. When he built a city, he called the name of the city after the name of his son, Enoch. To Enoch was born Irad, and Irad fathered Mahujael, and Mahujael fathered Methushael, and Methushael fathered Lamech. And Lamech took two wives. The name of the one was Ada, and the name of the other, Zillah. Ada bore Jabal. He was the father of those who dwell in tents and have livestock. His brother's name was Jubal. He was the father of all those who play the lyre and pipe. Zillah also bore Tubal Cain. He was the forger of all instruments of bronze and iron. The sister of Tubal Cain was Naamah. Lamech said to his wives, Ada and Zillah, hear my voice. You wives of Lamech, listen to what I say. I have killed a man for wounding me, a young man for striking me. If Cain's revenge is sevenfold, then Lamech's is 77-fold. And Adam knew his wife again. And she bore a son and called his name Seth. For she said, God has appointed for me another offspring instead of Abel, for Cain killed him. To Seth also was a son born, and he called his name Enosh. At that time, people began to call upon the name of the Lord. Thus ends this reading of God's inerrant and inspired word. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God will stand forever. Would you pray with me? Father, your word says all of Scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness, that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. And so we hold you to your word. We come banking on your promise that you will meet with us through your word and that this has meaning for our lives, significance for our souls. But most importantly, we come to meet with you. We do not come to hear the opinions of men, but the word of our God. And we pray, O Lord, speak, for your servants listen. That you would open our eyes to behold the wonders of your word. That you would incline our hearts to your testimony. That you would unite our hearts in the fear of your name. And that you would satisfy us this morning with your steadfast love. For in you we trust. Give us ears to hear, Lord. I pray as your servant, as your unprofitable servant, would you use me to accomplish your purposes for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, most of you who know me know that apart from the Bible, probably my favorite book in the world is Pilgrim's Progress, written by John Bunyan some 300-odd years ago. John Bunyan was that famous Puritan Baptist preacher who was thrown into prison for preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ. He stayed multiple years there because he refused to promise not to preach. And during those years in prison, he redeemed the time by writing what has come down to us as one of the greatest works in English literature. this book. And this book isn't simply a work of literature, it's also an inspiration for the Christian life because it happens to be an allegory of the Christian life. You see, in this book, you have your protagonist, your hero, a man named Christian, ironic enough. And Christian is on his way from the city of destruction to the celestial city in order to be with his King, his God, his Christ. And on the way, he encounters many difficulties, many trails, difficulties and terrors and problems and people. And each one of those is meant to be a metaphor that symbolizes something that we encounter in our life and in our journey to heaven to be with Jesus. Well, in the middle of this book, he and his good friend, Faithful, come to a specific town called Vanity Fair. And it's called Vanity Fair because in this town, there is a fair that goes all year round. And as they come into this town, they are struck by all the affluence and opulence in this town. Everything that a person could want is in this town. And Bunyan writes it like this: therefore, at this fair, they sell much merchandise as houses, land, trades, places, honors, promotions, titles, countries, lusts, pleasures of all sorts. And along with all this, at this fair, there is constant round-the-clock entertainment and other amusements of every kind. Vanity Fair has come down to us, not simply through the book Pilgrim's Progress, but many other authors have used that title for magazines, for books, for movies. We have television shows called Vanity Fair. All of it actually comes from John Bunyan's book in this specific scene, this specific situation. And there's really only two responses to encountering Vanity Fair in the book. One is if your heart has not been transformed by the gospel of Jesus Christ, if God has not given you a love for his son and an awareness of the truth of his word, then when you arrive in Vanity Fair, you're pleasantly surprised. You're overwhelmed by all the good things around you, all the comforts, all the conveniences that culture can provide, and you reside there. You stay there. After all, who would ever want to leave this place? But if you are a Christian, then as you walk into Vanity Fair, you recognize it for what it actually is. It is the goodness of God and the gifts of God turned on their head to distract and derail Christians from their journey towards Jesus. It is a siren call of this world leading to destruction. It is the lullaby seeking to drift you off to sleep, spiritual slumber, so that you do not pay attention to what is actually happening and this, what is at stake in your life and for your soul. Every Christian has to encounter Vanity Fair. Every Christian has to deal with the comforts of this world and the convenience of culture and say, is this enough for me, or do I want something more, something eternal? But you don't have to go to John Bunyan's book to find that. Every Christian in every generation has to deal with this challenge. In the Bible, we see it go by many different names, Vanity Fair. In the Old Testament, it's Egypt, it's Nineveh, it's Babylon. In the New Testament, it's Rome. It's the superpowers of their time. It's the nexus of culture and trade. And if you're in love with this present world, you go with them. But if you follow Jesus, you run afoul of them. And that's what happens in the book. You have Christian and Faithful who begin to be persecuted as they go through Vanity Fair. They see all the signs. They see all the false promises of this world. And yet they stop their ears. They keep their eyes closed. They keep moving forward until they offend everybody in the fair because they will not buy what they're selling. And eventually they murder poor Faithful. And Christian has to escape with his life. In the New Testament, this materialism, this love for the flesh, goes by the name in the book of Revelation as Mystery Babylon the Great. But we also see it here in Genesis chapter 4. That's what our passage is talking about. We see here in Genesis 4 the beginning of Vanity Fair. We see here in Genesis 4 the beginning of pursuing the things of this world instead of God. And we see two ways to live. Now, as we drop into our passage, starting in verse 16, we pick up with Cain where we left off last week. And you, even if you weren't here last week, most of you, if you've been to church or if your grandma dragged you to Sunday school or if you went to vacation Bible school as a kid, you've heard the story of Cain and Abel, right? We have Adam and Eve, the progenitors of all humanity. They have two babies. One is Cain, one is Abel. When Cain is born, Eve rejoices. She says, listen, God promised me offspring. He promised he would crush the head of the serpent. He would crush the power of the devil. He would bring us back to God. I have finally gotten this child. And then she's overjoyed when she has a second child. And these two children grow up with so much promise and so much hope. And yet as they grow, they diverge in paths. You have Abel who worships the Lord. You have Cain who worships himself. And so when they're called to present themselves before the Lord and they both offer an offering, God accepts the offering of Abel, but not the offering of Cain. And Cain, in his jealousy and rage and bitterness, lashes out and kills his brother. That's the part we all know. And probably the moral of the story when you were a kid is don't be like Cain. Don't hit your brother or sister, right? I've used that with my kids. But here, the second half of chapter 4, this is the part that you don't hear. This is the part that you may not know, because we're going to find out what happens to Cain and what happens to his family after God pronounces judgment, after God sentences him and casts him out of his presence. He says, you will go and wander the land. You will have no rest, and the ground will not provide for you. And yet, in chapter 17, the text tells us that Cain's wife conceived and bore them a son. Now, here's where we have to deal with the question. That is, where exactly does Cain's wife come from? I mean, so far we have Adam, we have Eve, we have Abel, we have Cain. Abel's dead. So where's Cain's wife coming from? Well, there's been a lot of different answers over a lot of different years from a lot of different scholars. But based on what the scripture says, as gross as it may sound, Cain's wife was undoubtedly either his sister or his niece, most likely his sister. And again, I know that sounds gross, but the Bible makes it very clear that Adam and Eve are the progenitors, the first parents of all of humanity. That's why in the Gospels, and specifically as the Gospel is unpacked in the New Testament, we're told that in Adam we all fell. We've all inherited Adam's sin, which means we all have to be descended from Adam and Eve. There is no room for different humanities. There's only one human race. Moreover, the reason why we don't know about Cain's wife is because Moses, as he's writing this, gives us the highlights. Adam and Eve are having other kids, but Moses is giving us the headlines, what we need to know, what's pertinent to our lives, and what we have to understand about God's word and about himself. And so we're not told the name of Cain's wife, but clearly this is his sister as well, or his niece. And not only are Adam and Eve having kids, but now we discover that Cain himself is having kids as well. And our text today traces the genealogy or the line of Cain. And here's the part that you probably have never heard, and this is the part that seems really crazy, and that is this. Cain does well. I mean, he really succeeds from a human perspective. His descendants, his kids, his grandkids become the most industrious and most successful men of their age. Alan Ross writes, or he's a scholar, writes, what became of the person who rebelled against God and left the land of blessing and angry defiance of the laws and sacrifices? He prospered. His line took the lead in producing cities, music, weapons, agricultural implements, in short, civilization. Such activity may have been their way to cope with life under the curse. It was their only recourse in a bitter life. Being separated from God, Cain's line enhanced their life with these refinements. Isn't that shocking? It just rubs you the wrong way. After all, he just murdered his brother, and he goes on to do all this good stuff, and his descendants seem to prosper in the land. It should be shocking to us. Because we think, you know, the biblical verse is, you reap what you sow. And that's true, ultimately, but sometimes not immediately. Or if you come from the secular worldview or from a Eastern religion worldview, it's like, well, karma says if you do bad stuff happens to you. But the reality in life is sometimes the bad people get ahead. Sometimes cheaters do prosper for a time. Sometimes good things happen to bad people. And the people who cheat and the people who stab you in the back or hurt you, they're the people that seem to be most successful. That's not easy to swallow. That's not fun to see or hear, but it does happen. It's a fact of life. And the Bible deals with real life, not just naive thinking or idealism. And it brings us to our first point. A life turned away from God will sometimes prosper. A life turned away from God will sometimes prosper from a specific point of view, for a time. We see this in Cain and his family. In verse 17, we're told that Cain builds a city. Now, don't let your imagination run wild here. City here in the Hebrew simply means a settlement. It's probably just a clump of buildings. But the reality is, it's the first recorded human city in history. Abel didn't do it. Adam didn't do it. Seth doesn't do it. Cain does. And he names it for his son, Enoch, which means to inaugurate or dedicate. It has the idea of a new beginning. Cain is saying, listen, we're starting over. We're resetting everything. From here on, this counts. This matters because this is my reputation on the line. It's a new beginning, and we're doing it without God. How do I know that? Well, remember, God sentenced Cain to wander. And yet here is Cain skirting the sentence of God and planting his flag and making a settlement and building a city for his name, and he's doing it because he wants to make a name for himself and for his family. This is still rebellion. This is still sin, even as he seems successful from a human perspective. And you know what? His grandkids are the same way. In verse 20, you have Jabal. He becomes the pioneer of husbandry and nomadic life. He raises his herds. You have his brother Jubal, who becomes the inventor of music. And in verse 22, we discover their half-brother, Tubal-Cain, becomes the founder of metallurgy. The text tells us he was a forger of all instruments of bronze and iron. And so Old Testament scholar Thomas Constable writes, Cain prospered even though he rebelled against God. This is another indication of God's grace. Cain's descendants took the lead in building cities, developing music, advancing agriculture, creating weapons, and spreading civilization. What are we supposed to do with that? Well, it's not so much what it tells us about Cain as what it tells us about God. We serve a gracious God. And in spite of Cain's sin, in spite of his brokenness and depravity, God still uses Cain to advance civilization. God still gifts and talents Cain and his descendants. This is what we call common grace. Common grace is a theological term that simply means grace, or God's gifting, God's favor and kindness and blessing on all people. It's common to all mankind, both believer and non-believer, both sinner and saint, both just anybody who is following their own heart or who's following after the Lord, God gives blessings to them both. It's what Jesus means when he talks about in Matthew chapter 5, where he says, for he makes his sun to rise on the evil and on the good. That's God. God allows sunshine, and then he sends rain on the just and on the unjust. And this deviates from all the ancient mythologies, because ancient mythologies take the technologies that come into mankind and from all the different advancements of humanity, and they always say, these are gifts specifically coming down from the gods. After all, humans can't do this. We're too puny. We're too dumb. And yet, in Christianity, the Bible teaches us that while God is the giver of all good gifts, one of the gifts he has given us is the image of God. And he's endowed mankind with ingenuity, with intellect, and creativity. And even in spite of Cain's sin, that image is still there. It's marred, it's scarred, but God is still blessing. God is still kind. And friends, that's not just for then, that's for today as well. We shouldn't be shocked when we see common grace. You don't have to be a Christian to be a skilled craftsman or a brilliant inventor or a good doctor. We shouldn't fall into the trap of believing that non-Christians have nothing to contribute or to teach us. Rather, when we see non-Christians doing something that is laudable or that is amazing, we should give thanks to God. It should roll up in praise to him, because it doesn't just tell us something about them. It tells us something about the God who gave the gift in the first place. He is good. He is benevolent. He loves and he is patient, but his goodness and his patience is always meant to lead us toward repentance. And that brings us to the second part of common grace, which is common grace is not sufficient grace. Common grace is not sufficient grace because common grace is not saving grace. Your talents, your gifts, your good works cannot save you. Only Jesus can do that. And we see this in the line of Cain because even as their civilization rises, their character drops off a cliff. This group of people have become so obsessed with their gifts that they've done so at the expense of the giver. They've lost track of God. There's no mention of God in this portion, in this line, in this genealogy. And there's an intentional reason behind that. They've rejected God even as they carry on with his grace. They take his gifts and they walk away. They become obsessed with the things they can see, with the tyranny of the urgent, with what they can do, and they forget what God has done and what he has promised. They want no part of it. They're planning the next 10 years, but they don't care about the next 10 billion. They don't care about what actually matters, what's eternal. And friends, again, that's not just a problem for Cain and his line. That's a problem here today for us as well. We can become so obsessed with our job, with good things, but good things that are not God things. We can become so obsessed with our family. We can become so obsessed with our hobby that we lose sight of Christ. And these things begin to take his place. We elevate the gift above the giver. It's idolatry. I've been working with the youth for several years, and one of the things that has changed in my heart is when I see a young student who is talented or gifted or attractive or they come from some form of means, I fear for that student. Because it seems the more gifting, the more talent, the more attraction they have, or the more money they come from, the more ammunition the enemy has to get at their heart. Because somewhere along the line, we lost the ability to give praise to God for his gifts, and it became the hubris and arrogance of man. And so all of a sudden, we don't even see it as a gift anymore. It's just something I do, something I earn, something I work for. It's all about me. And it's so easy for the world to use those giftings or that beauty or that money in order to draw that student away from Jesus, to distract and derail that Christian life, and ultimately to destroy them. That's not just in the youth group either. That's right here in this room. That's in me. That's in ministry. I remember several years ago, when I was first, just right out of college, my wife and I went as part of a team to Paraguay, South America, very poor country in the interior, and we go, and we're dealing in some of the slums of one of the suburbs of the capital, and just poverty on a level I'd never seen. Even growing up in inner city Detroit, I'd never seen this kind of poverty, this kind of need, the physical needs, the spiritual need, the financial needs. It was just so overwhelming. We lived with these people. We stayed at their homes at night, if you can call them homes, and just your heart broke for these people. And we shared the gospel, and I had some of the sweetest moments of communion with other Christians from other countries that I've ever encountered. And yet on the flight back, we're on a 747. We land in a large city in Brazil, and we enter this airport, and this airport is tricked out even more than American airports. I mean, it is clean and pristine. It is wealthy, and the affluence and opulence that is on display in this airport, which is, it was such a contrast with where I just was. I couldn't wrap my head around it. It was so difficult to see that, and in the back of my mind, I'm looking at all these different stores with all of these different products, because in the airport you don't have to pay like the duties and taxes that you pay in the country, and so they got all this stuff there right out front, right in your face, and I'm looking at this, and I hear doubt creep in, saying, what could you possibly give those people in Paraguay? What do you have that they can't get from here or from people like this? What use are you? And I remember thinking to myself, from a human perspective, that's true. I'm a dirt poor college student. I mean, from Paraguay's perspective, I was very well off. But from an American perspective, again, eating ramen noodles. But since then, I've come to realize that what I had that was invisible was the gospel of Jesus Christ. And Jesus is more valuable than all the airports in the world combined. And I couldn't help those people in the ways I wanted. I couldn't bring them out of squalor and poverty. I couldn't deal with all their medical situations, but I could offer them the hope of eternity in Jesus to know his love. The problem is we miss it. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 says, as we look not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. For the things that are seen are transient. That means passing away, it's changing, it's a vapor, it's a mirage. But the things that are unseen are eternal. Cain misses that. His family misses that. The commentator Matthew Henry writes that worldly things are the only things that carnal, wicked people set their hearts upon, and they are the most ingenious and industrious about. So it was with the impious race of cursed Cain. Here were a father of shepherds and a father of musicians, but not a father of the faithful. Here was one to teach in brass and iron, but none to teach the good news of the Lord. Here were devices how to be rich, how to be mighty, how to be merry, but nothing of God, nor of the fear, nor of his fear and service among them. End quote. You see, sin can only succeed at things that are not of eternal value. And I'm reminded of the words of Jesus. What does it profit a man if he gains the whole world and loses his soul? What will you give for your soul? I'm reminded of the missionary William Carey, who said, I'm not afraid of failure. I'm afraid of succeeding at things that don't matter. But the reality is people are not stagnant. We're always moving in one direction or the other. And in this case, Cain's family, as they reject God, move away from God. They're getting worse. It's not just that they miss God. It's that their rebellion against God's law and God's design and God's will grows. And that brings us to our second point. Sin will always spread in a life turned away from God. Sin will always spread in a life turned away from God. They're away from the presence of God. They want no part of God. They're taking God's gifts. They're moving in their own direction, and they're going to do it their way. Because without salvation from sin and a heart turned back to God, we will quickly twist God's gifts until we warp and distort them to accomplish our own evil purposes, to satisfy our own evil desires. And we see this explicitly in the life of Lamech. We see it in his marriages. Yes, marriages. He takes two wives. This is the first polygamous relationship in the entire Bible. This is the first time that mankind deviates from God's design for marriage. But he won't be the last. And the question sometimes is asked, well, how do you know he's wrong? I mean if Lamech does it, it's in the Bible. How do you know? The text doesn't specifically say he's wrong. It doesn't have to. The guy's a dope. It's clear. It's implied in the text. You're not supposed to follow Lamech. Moreover, it's not part of God's design. We know that from Genesis chapter 2. God made man and woman, the gender binary, in order to be married to one another. Jesus picks up that same gender binary, that same design from God, and says the same thing in Matthew 19. He says, have you not read that he who created them from the beginning made them male and female, and said, therefore, a man shall leave his father and mother and hold fast to his wife, and the two shall become one flesh. So they are no longer two, but one flesh. What therefore God has joined together, let not man separate. This is the prescription. This is the formula for marriage given to us by God in creation, through Jesus, and expounded upon by the Apostle Paul in Ephesians chapter 5. Moreover, the law of God in the Old Testament prohibits this kind of marriage. Deuteronomy 17, it says the kings of Israel were not to multiply wives. And you may say, well, that's just for kings. There's a reason for that. Because kings were the representatives of all the people. Moreover, kings were the most powerful and most rich of anybody else. If anybody was going to have multiple wives, it was the kings. Finally, the pattern of examples in Scripture makes it clear that polygamy or any deviation from God's design for marriage always leads to destruction, division, and death. We know that because most of the people who do it are evil men, and even the Christians who do it end up regretting it. Look at the story of Abraham, Jacob, David, Solomon. Every one of them leads to division in their family and destruction and death because it is sin. It is rejecting God's design for God's gift. And so it's explicitly in the text that their sin is getting worse. It's progressing. It's metastasizing. But it's also implicit, not just in Lamech, but also in his sons, specifically Tubal Cain. Now, here's the thing you can't really see in your English translation, but each one of their names says something about what they accomplished in life. And so Tubal Cain, Tubal literally means hammer. And when you consider he's the father of metallurgy, he begins to forge metal. You can understand why they called him Tubal, why they call him the hammer. But why Cain? Cain, who is his ancestor. Cain, who's most known for a murder and his violence. And the reason being is because in forging metal, it's not just that he forged tools for agriculture. Most likely, and most scholars agree, that the way Moses is writing this, he's setting you up to understand Tubal Cain is forging weapons to murder other people. And that's why Moses sets it up where you start with Lamech, who has three kids, and then you get the last one, Tubal Cain. He makes these weapons, and then it moves right to Lamech boasting about murder. In other words, he's using the weapons of his son in order to kill people, and then he's bragging about it. And then we have the very first song in human history recorded in the book of Genesis. In verse 23 and 24, Lamech said to his wives, Ada and Zillah, hear my voice. You wives of Lamech, listen to what I say. In other words, mark my words. I have killed a man for wounding me, a young man for striking me. If Cain's revenge is sevenfold and Lamech's is 77-fold. In other words, I'm big, I'm bad, you can't touch me, and if you do, I'll kill you. He's bragging about violence. He's bragging about killing people, creating the image of God. But it even gets worse. Notice he says, if Cain's revenge is sevenfold, Lamech's is 77-fold. If you recall, who promised to avenge Cain sevenfold if somebody hurt him? It wasn't Cain. It was God. When God pronounces judgment on Cain, Cain whines and says, this punishment is too much for me. They'll cut me down. They'll kill me. And what does God do? I'm going to put a mark on you, a sign that says you belong to me, and if they touch you, I will avenge you sevenfold. Now here's Lamech saying, you think God is going to be a problem for you? See what I do to you. This is absolutely blasphemous. He's trying to take the place of God. This is the Garden of Eden all over again. Not only am I not satisfied with losing sight of God, now I'm going to be God. The problem is God's not impressed with his violence, God's not impressed with his talents or gifts, and God's not impressed with their civilization. Judgment is coming. And we know that because the next couple chapters are going to unpack for us the flood, where God destroys this civilization. And friends, can I just caution you here today? Wherever you're at, on the basis of the authority of Scripture, on the promises of God, I can tell you, judgment is coming for us as well. The Bible says it is destined for man to die once, and then comes the judgment. You will answer before the throne of Christ for every thought, every word, and every action you have taken. And what will you say then? You will either stand on the basis of your own merit and your gifting and your talent and say, I can do it. Or you will stand there in the finished work of Christ. But there are only two ways to live. This is the first, the way of Cain. It is rebellion against God. It is prosperity in God's world, but ultimately it is met with death and destruction. And we see the second way to live at the very conclusion in verse 25. The text tells us, and Adam knew his wife again, and she bore a son and called his name Seth. For she said, God has appointed for me another offspring instead of Abel, for Cain killed Abel. I want you to think about this just for a second. You're Adam and Eve. You've been kicked out of the garden. Then you have this baby, Cain, and you're like, all your hope is here. You're so excited. There's so much promise in the birth of a child, and this is your baby boy. And then you're overjoyed because you have a second child. God is blessing us. And then as they grow up, you start to see the flaws in their character, and you start to see the dangerous anger in Cain, and then eventually Cain actually murders Abel, and so you lose your one child, and your other child's a murderer, cast out from the presence of God, exiled from being with you, and you're left desolated and devastated. What do we do? And God, I thought you said that you were going to save us, and you were going to use the offspring to do it, and now one's dead, and the other one is completely disqualified. What do we do? And yet she names him Seth, which is eerily similar to the Hebrew word for granted. It's the idea of God has again provided. God has given us this child. And not only that, she refers to him as the offspring. And that word is very significant because it's the same word that God used in his promise back in Genesis 3:15. Back after the fall, when God pronounces judgment on Adam and Eve, he also promised, I will put enmity between the serpent, that is the devil, and the woman, and between your offspring and her offspring, and he shall bruise your head. That is, he will crush the power of the devil. He will overcome sin. He will destroy death, and you shall bruise his heel. In other words, this offspring, this savior, this deliverer would save people and crush the power of the devil by being attacked by the devil, by receiving a mortal blow in himself. This was accomplished by none other than Jesus himself. Jesus died for your sins in your place as your substitute, specifically so that you might go free from the penalty of your sin, so you would not suffer the wrath of God and you would not be a slave to sin and the devil, so that you might have eternal life in Christ. And yet, here's Eve saying, God has provided me an offspring. God is fulfilling his promise. I didn't know how it was going to work. I didn't know how it was going to happen, but I have trusted his promise even when I couldn't see it, even in the devastation of sin, and now God is coming through because God always keeps his promises. Friends, you realize Noah comes through Seth. Abraham comes through Seth. David comes through Seth. Jesus comes through Seth. And that's because God always keeps his promises. And that brings us to our third and final point. A life trusting in the promises of God is better than all the prosperity and power of this world. A life trusting in the promises of God is better than all the prosperity and power of this world. Verse 26 goes on to say, to Seth also was born, a son was born, and he called his name Enosh. At that time, people began to call upon the name of the Lord. And so here you have the offspring, you have the child, you have God's promise being carried on into the next generation, and Seth seems to be a godly man, and yet he names his son Enosh, which literally means weak one or faint one. And I think there's something incredibly telling about that, because Seth is basically admitting, listen, I'm not as strong as my older brother. My family might not be as accomplished or as prosperous, as wealthy, but we will trust in the name of the Lord our God. We will hold fast to his promises. We will be faithful to his word because we are looking to him to save us. We cannot save ourselves. And friends, isn't that the message of the gospel? 1 Corinthians 1, Paul tells us, for consider your calling, brothers. Not many of you were wise according to worldly standards. Not many of you were powerful. Not many of you were of noble birth. But God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are, so that no human being might boast in the presence of God. You realize you have to come to the end of yourself before you come to Christ. That was Cain's problem. Cain was out for Cain. Seth saying, I'm weak, I'm small, my family might be weak, but we trust in your strength, O Lord, that you will save us. And this is the difference. The text tells us at that time, people began to call on the name of the Lord. Here's two ways to live. Here's two ways to encounter Vanity Fair. Cain's line places its emphasis on culture. Seth's line prioritized worship. Cain's line wanted to make a great name for themselves. Seth's line called on the name of the Lord. And here's the question from the text. Which one are you? Let's pray. Father, as we close today, I pray, would you open our hearts to understand our great need, that we would have a desperation for you, that we would recognize reality as it is, that apart from Christ, there is no salvation, for there is no other name under heaven by which we must be saved. But Lord, simply through faith and trusting in Jesus, through casting ourselves upon him, we might have eternal life. May we walk in humility and in praise for our God. In Jesus' name, amen.
Please join us one more time.
and all will see how great, how great is our God.
Let me end with a question and a verse. The verse is found in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. And here's the question. What is the disposition of your heart? Is it, look what I can do, or look what he has done? Let's pray. Father, I ask for all here that we would be amazed at what Christ has done for us, what only he can do, and that all here would know his love, and that we would be able to boast in our weakness because we know you, the one true God. Lord, do not let us fall asleep to the lullaby of this world, to be distracted and derailed from pursuing you by just the trifles that we find in our culture. But may we see Christ as worthy and follow him with our whole heart. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for worshiping with us. God bless you.